Back guys, this is Ibrahim Qureshi here, and today we are going to do a quick session on templates. And what we are going to do is we are going to install a template and install Windows 2019 using a template, and then we'll be configuring it as an Active Directory server. And once it is configured as an Active Directory server, we will be testing it out. We will also doing a little bit more than installing Active Directory. We will be installing DNS as well, because that is a mandatory requirement to have DNS if you are trying to set up a virtual lab. So from the point of view of setting up a virtual lab, if you are doing it at your home, the first thing you should be installing on your ESX is a Windows server, set up as a Active Directory server, and also install AD services. Along with AD services, you install the DNS from there. Okay, so I am just opening my slides. Just give me a second. Let's go back up. So in short, what is a template? Template basically is a same virtual machine which you have installed. You might just use that machine as a vanilla build, which basically just has the OS or has some basic applications which you need. Or you might have it, you know, as your primary goal template, which has the core application. If you know, need some applications like Office and everything, you might need to use that. What happened? Let me switch the presentation. Swap it. Okay, so today we are going to look at templates. Templates are very useful. We can use a template for so many reasons. So templates can be used just for making sure you are getting the consistent application, consistent OS deployed every time, and you have all the features and permissions in there, and it can save a lot of time, simple as that. So what we do is we install an OS. And once the OS is installed, you install your patches. Say for example, once the patches are installed, you install the applications which you need, which are very important to you and which are used on a daily basis. And once everything is there, you call it a goal template, and you basically mark that virtual machine as a template. So in a minute, we'll go into the demo, and we'll see what I mean by that. Now in the previous session, we have covered what is a virtual machine, and we have seen so many other things in there. Like obviously what consists a virtual machine, like the CPU, memory, disk, and virtual hardware and VMware tools. So this is no different than that. So let's go back and let me open the vCenter server. And there you go. So on the vCenter server, what we'll be doing is we'll be working on this tab now, which is the second tab, which is called VM and template tab. So I have already got a template for Windows somewhere here. Just need to find it. Yeah. So Windows 2019, and I have updated it in September. So when I say updated, I have done Microsoft security patches up to date till September. So next month I might reopen it, and then I might update the patches again, and then I will call it November. Or if I haven't done it in November, then it will be still September. So I know that the template is patched till September only. So that's another tip for you guys to keep a track on. And it's always going to be a little bit of task when you're using templates to make sure the template is up to date with the security patches and everything. So be sure to do that. Let me open the screens and people can see me as well. Okay, let's leave it there. So today what we are going to do is we are going to how to create a virtual machine last time, and we did the virtual machine session, and today we are covering templates, and we are going to use this template and create a virtual machine. So you right click on the template and you say new VM from this template. Okay, you call it a name. We will be calling it test AD, because we are going to make this a AD server. Okay, I'm going to deploy this and I'm going to leave this in the discovered virtual machine folder, and I'm going to leave this in this virtual machine. So that is the resource, the compute which I have selected, and now I'm selecting where it needs to be installed. So I've recently upgraded my lab with super fast NVMe memory, and this is the data store for that. So the deployment should be pretty quick. So select that, and I'm not going to do any customization at this moment. Let's leave this. We will cover it under a brand new session on how to customize and you know, the IP addresses and all that, and how to customize the hardware. So that will be a new session for that. So let's click on next, and that's pretty much it. You are just deploying a template, and this is the host you're deploying it to, and this is the data store you're deploying it to, and the disk format will be the same, which is basically as I always say, I'll do thin provisioning. Okay, so we'll be thin provisioning it. Finish. Now at the bottom you can see it is getting deployed, and as I said, this is NVMe, so it should be pretty quick. So it's 40% done already.
So why do you choose thin provisioning? Can you also not choose thick or like hybrid?
So there are three choices. We have thick provisioning, eagerly zero, thick provisioning, lazy zero, and also thin provisioning. The VM is deployed, and I will show you the difference now. We will go and click on the, we'll find the VM now, and I'll show you. So it was test. So that's how quickly it was deployed. We started deploying it as 7:30:02, and it finished deployment. This one is that one, isn't it? Let's squeeze this here. So when did it finish? The completion is done
7:32.
7:32. Where is it showing? Oh yeah, here it is. This one is this, yes. Task here. So it, yes, took how many minutes? 37 seconds. So, and it finished within 30 seconds then. 32, 16 seconds.
One minute something seconds.
So that's how fast it is. Now imagine when I created this template, I installed it first, going through the wizard, created a virtual machine, mounted the ISO, installed it. Installed the Windows 2019. Once it is installed, I updated the OS with Microsoft security patches, and all that, yes, took more than 2 hours for me to create, yes, it and to update it. So I saved 2 hours, and I have done a new brand new machine for myself for 1.5 minutes. That is awesome, right? That is saving time. That is basically saving a lot of time. So if you do not want to go back and do a new machine every time you need one, you create a template, you put everything, you install a machine, put everything you need in there, and basically create a template, and next time you need one, that's how quickly you can get one machine running for you. And that's another advantage. Ahmed, you were asking about advantages of virtualization, right? So guys, this obviously is going to be on my YouTube channel. I have a Zoom session running, and I have a few subscribers of mine who wanted to see how to deploy AD and how to use templates. So they have been asking a lot of good questions, and I think they are all valid questions. So let's see why we did thin provisioning. So basically, this virtual machine which I have created, let me move this aside now, is having some memory, right? Storage. So it is actually using how much storage? 15 GB used. Okay, can you see that, Arshad? How much is it used? 15 GB.
Yes, okay. I can.
But how much is allocated? Even the C drive has 100 GB. Okay, but how much is it using at the moment? Only 15. When it is deployed, it's using 15, and that is how much I'm actually using on the storage. Now the advantage is, disk is not cheap. Okay, it might seem to be very cheap these days because you know, you can get a 1 terabyte USB you know, drive on eBay for less than £20, but or Amazon as well. But have you look at this disk over here? I have right click and edit the settings, and you can see it's 20 GB. Sorry, 100 GB, right? And that is what we are seeing here as well, 100 GB. But actually, it has only used 15 GB. That is how much it is actually using. So actual data is only 20 GB. If I thick provision it, eagerly zero or lazy zero, it will automatically take 100 GB. And that 100 GB is gone. Now imagine if you are having a small data store. Well, it's not a small data store. It's 800 GB data store capacity I have. Yeah, and 500 is free. If I thick provision this machine, 100 GB will be gone. I will be left with 400 GB. If I do another one, I'll be left with 300 GB. If I do another one, I'll be left with 200 GB. If I create a virtual machine which is like like a vCenter server, and I thick provision it, vCenter server itself basically takes 400 GB. Then basically it will give me an error message saying you don't have enough space to create another virtual machine. That this NVMe memory, it cost me 100 and something pounds just to like, this is a 1 terabyte one, but if you look at it, I have only provisioned 800 GB. 200 GB basically is reserved for increasing capacity later on when I struggle. But that is a, you know, wastage, right? If you want to use the virtualization on every level, so thin provisioning allows us to use the storage virtualization more efficiently, because what will happen is only when the data is written, it is actually going to use it. This doesn't mean that it will go beyond 100 GB. The maximum it can go is still 100 GB, because the virtual disk size we have configured is only 100 GB. Does it make sense, guys?
Yes.
So it does make sense, yeah? So again, it's a good example, because obviously I only have 500 GB. If I configure 5 VMs, my storage will be gone. But instead, how many VMs I have configured here? Can you see? If I click on this storage, and if I go on the data store and I click VMs, I have these many VMs running on it. And how much are these VMs provisioned to? So let's see that. This is the vCenter server. 400 GB is the provisioning, and it's actually using 33 GB. Okay, so 400 GB is gone. If I thick provision it, 400 GB will be gone. Jump server, okay. 120 GB, and it's only using 23 GB. Okay, another DC server, 118 GB, and it's only using 40 GB. So here, 400, 500, 600 is gone. And here I have another vCenter running. It is using 500 GB. So if I thick provision this, it is actually 1 terabyte already gone here. And this VM is also running here, which is 100 GB. So 1100 GB is already gone. But in reality, because I have thin provisioned, I have managed to provision so many disks, and still I have only used 293 GB. 300 GB I have used. So can you see the advantage, guys, of why we are using it thin provisioned? And this is why when I was talking to you yesterday, Suraj?
Yes.
What did I tell? Do you remember when you provision a VM?
Yes, yes. You told me that use thin provisioning.
Exactly. And you know why now, yeah?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, so the VM is created. Let's quickly open the VM. Let's power it on. Test AD.
I want four.
Let me start the recording. I need to do some editing, I guess, when daughter was in the video. Okay, so we are going to power this VM on now. This is our brand new VM which we have used, which we have created using template. Let's power it on. Go to summary. Now the VM basically is having how much resources? Let's have a look at here. So we have given it only 2 CPUs and 4 GB memory and 100 GB disk. But actually it was 15 GB when we started it, but now it's gone to 20 GB now. So it started using more space as it is booting up. Okay, or when it was provisioning, maybe it was, you know, not done completely. It was 15 GB and now it's showing 20 GB altogether. So as you can see over here, it's booting. So we are going to click on remote console because it opens here and it will be a big screen. So first thing what we'll do is, because we just provisioned this VM, and this is what you have to do after provisioning a VM as well. If you haven't used customization, the VM will boot with a IP address which will be a dynamic, if you have a dynamic IP address configured. Now, because if we don't, then what we have to do, the first thing you have to do is log into the console with Control-Alt-L. You need to know the root password or admin password for your VM as well. Once you log into this VM, you need to change the IP address and set an IP address which you want to set, you want to use. Okay. Once you set the IP address, then what we'll do is basically we will install the application which we need. Now, in this case, we are going to make this VM Active Directory server. So we will install the AD on there. Okay. So because I have used customization, it is basically asking me to do remote client. Let's open that. So it should come up here. Let's pull that here. So it's basically we use sysprep to do customization. So now it's asking us to configure it as a out of box, as if you're installing a new VM. So click on next. Licensing accepted. Set a root password. Can you boys please make sure you're paused, because there is some background noise of fan or something running, and it's quite hard to take the background noise off sometimes. That's better, thank you. Okay, so this is the first time we have logged in. Do you want to allow this PC to be discovered? You have to give yes. So first thing what we'll be doing is making sure we set a network. So this is our server manager. This is where we'll be doing all the configuration and everything. So click on local server. And then what we'll do is basically you can see Ethernet here, Ethernet 0. Click on that. And that will basically take you to the network. Click on properties. And here we'll be changing the IP address. So we'll be setting an IP address. Let's set it to 211 for now. Now we will not be configuring any of the DNS or anything, because we are going to make this AD server. So that's all for now. What we'll do is we'll click on OK and we'll click on OK again. So the IP address is set. We can go and check that CMD IP config, and we can see the IP address is set. Now let's ping it. The reason I want to ping is I want to check whether the network is set up properly or not. Yeah, I am able to ping it. Just so we have seen the IP address and it is the right IP address. I can ping it. That means the network is enabled on the template. Sometimes VMware basically disables the network, which is a good thing, I think, because accidentally if you clone a VM, there's another feature which VMware allows you to do, which is called cloning. We'll look into it in the next session. If you clone a VM, what happens is basically you're cloning everything with it. That means the IP address as well of the previous VM which you're cloning will be there. So if you accidentally power it on, then you have two servers with the same IP, 210 or 211. and it can create IP conflict. It's a bad scenario. It's a bad situation to be in. Okay. Let's basically start doing the configuration. Now, okay, so what we need to remember is before we install Active Directory, we need to make sure the server which you are making Active Directory server is having a static IP address at least, right? Because you wouldn't want the server to have a dynamic IP address and lose the IP. The server will lose the IP accidentally, which is a bad scenario. Okay, so let's get back to our session. Now, because I have configured the IP address, what we can do now is we can directly RDP to this machine. So let's just do that. Go to run and then go mstsc. And then we will give the IP address. Now there's a fair chance this will not work because it might have the remote desktop disabled. I'll show you if it is disabled how to enable it as well. Okay, it is not disabled. So we will click on more and different user and we'll log in as an administrator. Now dot slash basically means login locally. It is not added to a domain anyway, but basically it's a good way to make sure that it's logging in locally as well. Accept the certificate warning. And it has opened here. There you go. So you are connected back to the session, but you are on an RDP session now. So what are we going to do now? We are going to install the Active Directory. So it is a big resolution here, I guess. Let me reduce the it should be okay. Yeah, it should be okay. So on the server manager, to install the AD, what you need to do is you need to go to manage and click on add role and features. That's good. At least it is big and you can see it clearly on the screen, if I don't mind that. Okay, so first thing first, Server Manager is a tool where you will be using, which you will be using to install all the roles and features. As you can see, start and remove roles and features wizard. Click on next. It will ask you, do you want to install it, this role or feature on this machine or a remote one? You could potentially use this machine to install on a remote one as well. Basically you can also enable remote desktop services installation as it says, but we'll just say role based or feature based installation. Click next and then see, this is the option where it is asking select the server from the pool, which is going to be this server. Now before that, I forgot that, now because we just deployed from template, the name it has chosen is a completely different name. Can you see that? It's a random name. I don't want to keep my AD, install my AD with that name. Now let's change the name first. To do that, what we need to do, I might need to give this server a reboot as well, because if you change the name, that will reboot, the server will reboot. So what we need to do is set a good name, right? We need to set up a good name anyway. So let's open the computer, my computer, go to home, and on home, basically what you need to go and do is click on home, click on this PC first and click on home, computer. And then you'll see system properties, click on that. On here you can see system information, click on that. And remember I was talking about the RDP access, you need to enable it. You'll do it from here, remote settings, you'll do it from there. But at the moment it is set up as, you know, this server name, we need to change that. We'll do it in a minute. Now I'll show you how to enable the remote desktop. If you have installed it for the first time, you need to go. This will be selected to do not allow remote connections to this computer, just select that and also make sure you untick that one. Okay, and then click on apply and okay. So that allows you to use RDP to remotely connect. Now let's change the name. So we go change and then we can say agile shall I use your name or shall I use your domain name as a test or not? Hello, Arshad. Okay, let's use the name Agile. Just the Agile name, okay? So click on OK. It will say that it will reboot, which is fine. You have to reboot anyway. You can keep an eye over here. Look how quickly it boots. Literally, it's going to boot now. It's running on NVMe, so it's going to be super fast. There you go, ready. So we can RDP again. So that's how fast it was.
Hello.
Hello, yeah.
NVMe means SSD, like.
It is flash. It is even faster than flash. The bitrate comparison is like 5000 megabits, so it's like 5 gig transfer rate.
Okay.
Normally SSDs basically are also called flash. They have up to 300, compared okay. 300 to 5000. So 5000 Mbps to 300 Mbps is massive improvement, right? Okay, so basically click on connect again. Yes.
Can you pause your recording okay. for a minute?
Okay, sure. Thank you.
So, okay, guys. So we have rebooted the machine, and I have named it Agile for the moment. And now we'll continue with the installation. So what we'll be doing is we'll be going to install the role, which is Active Directory Services. To do that, on the computer manager, you need to go and open Add Remove Features. And click on next. Role base or feature based installation, click on next. That is the computer we are installing. Now you can see the name has changed to Agile. Click on next. Select Active Directory users and computers. Sorry, Active Directory domain features. So you need to select Active Directory domain services. That is what you are going to select, which is basically what you're going to do. So it will automatically give you these things. It will give you Active Directory tools, administration tools, ADDS and ADLDS tools, Active Directory module for PowerShell, and also Active Directory Administrative Center, and ADDS, Snap-in, and command line tools. So all this will be automatically added. So click on Add Features. Now, as I said, we will not just run Active Directory, we will also need, if this is your lab environment and this is the first server you're building, what will happen is on your environment, if it is a green field, you don't have anything in your environment. You have your first server, you basically install ESX on it, and then first thing you install when you install ESX on it is your AD server and DNS server. Maybe people don't need a DNS, AD server, they might not need Active Directory at all, but they if you want to install vCenter, it's mandatory to have a DNS. So at least install a Linux server and run, you know, Linux Unbind or something like that, or any Linux DNS services. I don't know which, like Suraj, which you do you prefer on Linux? Which DNS services do you prefer?
Bind server.
Bind. You use Bind, yeah? Okay. Yeah. Unbound as well. There is something called Unbound. Have you heard? So there is one something called Unbound as well. I think I used it on FotonOS. Okay, anyway, so we will need to select DNS, and that is also going to add some AD administration tools for DNS, and tools with DNS server tools will automatically get with that, and make sure you include them and add feature. Now click on next after you click that. Can you see the screen properly? Yeah. So we'll click on next.
Sorry to interrupt. Do we already have installed the ESX, or are we going to install it later?
No. You install the ESX. On the ESX, this is the first virtual machine you're installing. Assume that. Okay.
Okay.
So on the ESX, obviously, if you install this on the server, then where are you going to install ESX? So ESX is the bare metal hypervisor. So on the bare metal, on your physical server, you install ESX, connect to the ESX with the IP address which you have given to the ESX, and then the first virtual machine you install is the DNS server. So if you want AD, then install AD and DNS services along with it running on the same one. If it is a lab, really you don't care, right? You can have more than one services running on one server. So that's what I mean, okay? And then we will click on next. And then it will include some of these. Group policy management, which is fine. I want that. And then remote server administration tools, which is still fine. So these are some of the services which it's going to install, which is good. Click on next. You don't want these. Just click on next. And there you go. This is pretty much it, guys. Click on next and then click on install. So what happens is, once the installation is done, it will need to go through. We will need to go through and promote this server as an Active Directory server. So we will need to do some more bits and stuff, which basically comes on the server manager which we have here. So this, remember this, guys, this is server manager which we are using here. So over here on the top, you'll get a message saying, see, now it's saying feature installation, and it's basically installing it on this server. So later on it will say, you know, pending task, and then you need to complete the configuration, so something like that. So let's bring this here so you can see. So it should be pretty quick. There you go. I think it's done. So you click on here and check it. Post deployment configuration. Yeah, promote this server to domain controller. There you go. The installation of AD is done. That's how simple it is. Okay, click on close.
Yes.
Click on this exclamation mark, and then basically promote this server to domain controller. Click on that. Let me bring this here. Now add domain controller to existing domain, or add a new domain to existing forest. Add a new domain. So I'm doing this demo for you guys to understand how to set up a new domain. So we will be basically creating a completely new domain controller. Go for it.
I have some basic questions. I remember this process. Well, like my question is, can you pause for a minute? I need to ask three different questions.
Okay, the question asked is, what is the difference between a new forest and these three options which we have here? So what is the forest and domain? We need to understand that first. So the main difference between forest and domain is that the forest is a collection of domain trees in an Active Directory, while domain is a logical group of multiple objects in Active Directory. Forest and domain are two such objects. They are two objects. So basically, a forest is like a big organization, right? It can be forest. In the forest, you have domains, small domains. Okay, so you can have multiple domains within the forest. And the domain, what is that have? The domain has multiple objects. So what are objects? Objects are users, computers, printers. All these things are objects within the Active Directory. Okay, and the forest is the top. It's like a tree. It's like a pyramid. So on the top, it's a forest. And at the bottom, you have Active Directory domains. So and most of the places, that's what they show as well. So in here, the three options we have is add a domain controller to an existing domain. So you can have a domain controller running, like I have my domain controller running. It is called agileops.co.uk. But I only have one domain controller. That is a single point of failure. If that server goes down, if that ESX goes down and it is running on this ESX server, everything will go down, right? So I want to have another domain controller which is running on another ESX host, and I will make sure these don't move and they both don't sit on one domain controller. Because what's the point of having both of them running on a single ESX host? If that host goes down, then the AD is gone. Then no one can log in. Make sense? So what we'll do is basically we'll make sure we have more than one domain controllers for resilience. And the domain controller, if you add an existing, if you use this option, add a domain controller to existing domain, what it does, it automatically synchronizes everything with that domain. So all, if I create a user here, this user is available here. If I get another user, this user is available here. In the DNS, if I create a DNS entry dot, you know, lab dot agileops dot co dot uk, this entry comes here. Yeah, if I create an entry called esx dot o1 dot agileops dot co dot uk, that entry comes here. So it is synchronizing. It synchronizes everything in the AD. And if you ask me, that is the best way to do it, right? Why would you have a single point of failure? And the way I have done it is I only have 2 GB RAM running on this AD server. Can you imagine? Running a 2019 AD server with only 2 GB RAM. It's running happily. It's only using 400 MB, 500 MB sometimes, you know. So for me, it's not a waste of resource, right? So that's what I have done. Now, what is the second option? Add a domain controller to existing forest. So you already have a forest. You know the name of the forest. You add a new domain controller. That means I can start a new domain called a completely different thing. Maybe I can say I have a domain called Agile Ops. I can start a new domain called Syndicate or something like that. Synergy maybe. Okay. I can create a new domain called Synergy, and that can be added to the same forest. So then I have Agile Ops domain and a different domain called Synergy. So that will be two different domains under the same forest. Does it make sense? Now, the third option which we are doing here is basically we don't have anything. We don't have, this is a brand new green site, greenfield I called. So in the greenfield, you don't even have a domain controller. So the first thing you do is set up a new forest. That means that will become your primary domain controller. Make sense? So let's start that. I want to name this Agile because that's what I named.
So we are creating a forest and this is our brand new domain.
Yeah, and this is the first domain in that forest. It's called Agile.
And it itself gonna be a forest and it itself gonna be a domain.
Exactly. This is the first forest and it will be the first domain controller in the forest. So automatically it will be creating the forest for us because that's the main thing you will be creating. And then within the forest, it will be creating the first domain controller, which will be agile.com.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And then click on next. There you go. Now this is very important. I would say, like, when you're installing an AD domain controller in any organization, if you already have other servers running in your organization which are 2016 and you do not have any 2008 servers running in your organization, then you select this. But if you do have any older servers, this is for backup compliant, this is for compatibility, domain controller capabilities. Yeah, so if you have any older domain controllers running, so forest functionality and domain functionality, they are two different things. So in the forest, if you still have 2008 R2 functionality, you need, because you have 2008 servers, client servers which are connecting to this, which are going to connect to this server, then make sure you select the forest functionality as 2008 R2 and also domain as that. Okay. But if you do not have 2008, maybe you can select 2002. If you have 2012. If you have 2012, select that. But if you don't have anything and you don't, obviously you won't be installing older versions anyway, then you basically select the latest one. Okay. Which is going to be 2016 at least. Okay. Does it make sense? Select that. And now we have to set up a password. Now, what is my domain? I have given agile.com. Click on next. Also notice there is an option for read-only domain controller. This is basically a good option used for remote sites where you do not have any users and you do not have any administrators to manage that site. It can be a remote location, but you have some users logging in, and for them to log in, it is going to be easier if you have a domain controller there, but you only need it as a read-only domain controller. You do not want to do any management or addition of DNS or additional of ADs and groups or anything like that. So in that scenario, you just select that read-only domain controller, and it is a short form there, RODC. But that is only possible if you already have a domain, right? Because we are setting up a brand new domain, this option is grayed out now. It doesn't even allow you to select it, that read-only domain controller, RODC. Does it make sense? Yeah. So because this is a brand new one, that's grayed out, but you could potentially have a read-only domain controller. So when I click next, it's saying create DNS delegation. Yeah, you can select that, but because this we don't have anything at this moment, pretty much this is a green field which we are trying to set up. This is what is saying, that you do not have any DNS server running here, so that's why it can't do anything. Just leave that option and then click on next, and basically it will resolve the NetBIOS name as agile.com, I'm hoping, or maybe it's just going to call it agile without the .com. Okay, agile zero it's calling it. Maybe it wants to keep it different. Agile should work. So let's leave NetBIOS domain name as agile and then click on next. So it's conflicting with the domain name which I have, server name which I have set to agile. So let's give agile 01 maybe, just to keep it different. This is why I always give agile hyphen 01 or something like that for computer names. It's always good to have that. So this is where it is going to store the database and the log files and the sysvol folder. Sysvol folder has all the information. It's like important folder for Active Directory. So you make sure you back up these folders at least to be able to recover the ADs if you want to. So database folder is NTDS, log folder is NTDS/windows/NTDS, and then sysvol folder. Click on next. And then you review what the options you have given. The only other option I have modified is the agile 01 for the NetBIOS name. And other than that, everything is pretty much by default. That's how simple it is. Click on next. Once this is finished, this will reboot and then it will ask you to log in to the domain controller as the administrator. So the by default, the administrator account which we have, there you go, all the pre-checks is done, and it is going to say that this is the Windows domain controller, have a default for security setting name, allow cryptography algorithm compatibility with Windows 4.0. So this is basically saying that it has weak passwords and all that. Prerequisite is done, successful. So now we can install. Click on install, and that's it. This is it, guys. This is how you install your first AD in your lab environment, or if you want to install it in production. But obviously that. This is simple as that. This is how simple it can be, really. And then once it's installed, because we have selected DNS, we will have DNS services running on the same server as well. Any questions, guys? So there you go. The Active Directory, the computer is being restarted because Active Directory domain services was installed or removed. So that means it is all done and it's ready. So the reboot is going to be super fast. We can keep an eye here. It's rebooting again. I might have just start MSTSC at the background. There you go. It's a restart. It might take a little bit time to configure these services because this is the first time it's booting up as a domain controller. Does it make sense? Oops, no. So, more choices. So we need to give administrator at agile.com.
Hello.
There you go. Services are all running, so we can see that. Yes, Suraj, do you have a question?
Yes, sir. आपने अभी remote desktop से उसका access लिया?
Yeah.
IDB से?
Yes.
आप direct उसका?
Okay, so we managed to log into the session now, and the first thing we will be doing is. We can go and open Active Directory users and computers. And you can see the domain. It is successfully installed. And we have these groups which are created by default. And the users which are here. And by default, the administrator is created. And this account has full access to the entire domain. You can see that it is domain admin, domain user. Any user we create, by default, it becomes a member of domain users. But because this is administrator account we are checking, it is also administrator, domain admin, domain user, enterprise admin, group policy, creator owners, and schema admin. Schema admin is basically the AD schema, which basically gets created when you create the Active Directory. So that basically is also there, schema admin. So what we can do here is we can create a user. And all these are called organizational unit. You can create a new organization unit by right click on the top of the AD and then saying organizational unit. And we can create a organization unit. Example, we are going to use this as an example called finance. Okay. And we can select protect container from accidental deletion, so no one can delete it. So this is the organization unit called finance, and then I am going to create a user in this unit. Maybe call it Sam King, last name Sam dot King is the username at agileops.co.tk. Next, set a password. So user must change a password when they log in, and then set up a password. You can leave it to change the password on first logon, or you can untick that. Okay, and then click on next, and that's it. That's first user created. So you can see the user here. Similarly, you can create a group for finance.
So can you hold for a second, Ibrahim? When you say agile.com, which is actually our Active Directory domain name, so you also created an organization unit. So is agile.com both in a domain name as well as an organization unit?
Yeah, agile.com is the name of your domain controller name.
Okay. Is it also a organization unit?
No, there is no organizational unit called Agile. This is the domain name only, agile.com.
But where did we just created organization unit?
Organization unit is finance which we created. This okay. is it. You can create another organizational unit called marketing. Go, see, right click on Agile.
Okay.
Or you can right click anywhere here.
Okay.
Right click, select Agile, which is the root domain. And then right click on here, and then you go new, and then basically what we do is if you want to create an organizational unit, click on organizational unit, and then you can create marketing. Okay, so now you have a marketing organization unit. You may have another department called development. Now, organizational unit is basically like folders. You are having folders created in AD to manage your users.
Users, okay.
Yeah, that's all it is. So you are creating folders in AD to manage your users. Like you have folders in your computer, you have so many files to keep, you create a folder and then you download all the files which you want. And then if they are all files related to finance, then you call it finance. If they are related to your job hunting maybe, so you call it, CVs or, job prospects, whatever you want to call, you can call it, right? At the end of the day, it's your choice. But in the Active Directory, you want to be organized. You can't just, go and create random things and start deleting random things. So you have to be a little bit organized. So that is what I'm trying to teach. So hopefully you enjoyed this session, guys. The last thing I want to show you is the DNS part. So So you can see the DNS is installed and Active Directory Services is installed. So you go to Tools, and to see the DNS, you go DNS. And then basically, this is our domain. And you can see there is a couple of things we need to do when you open DNS. You need to create a reverse lookup zone. What does that mean? As I was saying, we have forward lookup zone and we have reverse lookup zone, right? So what we have to do is we have to click on forward lookup zone, and we can see our domain here, Agile. Now, if I want to create a new computer or if I want to create a new DNS entry for this, so you go right click and add host, and then I can create a host. Now you can see that Agile is already added there. Let me cancel that. Agile is already added there, right? You can see that, right? What does that mean? That means let me go down a little bit. I just need to go open the command prompt. So if I ns lookup Agile, is one thing we need to do here is basically we need to add, go to local server, and this is another thing which I have found. Even when you are installing AD and also DNS, and when you are creating your first recent entry, you need to basically give this server as your DNS server, right? Because this is running DNS. Now what we have to do here is you have to basically add the loopback address, which is by default it comes up here. So 127.0.0.1 is basically this server. It's basically a loopback, so it's going to ping itself. So it's saying you are your own DNS server. Does it make sense? Or you can also add 10.10.10.211, which is basically this IP of this server itself, as you can see here. Click OK, and then that's it. Pretty much we are done. Let's try it again. Actually, let's try ping. Yeah, if I ping Agile, it's saying it's working, but it's using IPv6. Okay, so what we are going to do is I was going to show you how to create a, let's close all this. So what we are going to see, let's start from the beginning. So you go Tools and DNS. So in the DNS you have the forward lookup zone and you have Agile here. So let's create a new A record for, maybe if you are trying to create your vCenter VCSA, and if you want to give the vCenter an IP address 10.10.10.212. First make sure that IP doesn't exist or someone else is not using that IP. So ping it before you assign it to any IP, 212. It's not responding, that means it doesn't exist on the network. Mostly the case, but if you have ping disabled, then it might not. So vcsa.agile.com. Okay, so that's the vCenter IP address.
Correct your IP.
Yeah, there's a lot of tens there. Now, if I say create associated pointer record for reverse lookup, it will give me an error message because the reverse lookup is not done. We didn't do that. But let's add, and this is the warning you get. Associated pointer record cannot be found. Click on OK. So what does that mean? So if you go to reverse lookup, there is nothing there. There is no zone created. So we need to create a reverse zone. And this will be the end of the session. So this is going to be a reverse zone. Say primary zone, because this is the only zone we are creating, to all the DNS servers running in this domain on the forest, because this is the first one we have created. This is our first domain in the forest, right? So select first. And what does reverse lookup do? Is basically, if I say 10.10.10.212, then it will resolve the name. So that is the job of reverse lookup. If I give you the name, the forward lookup basically gives you the IP address. But if I give you an IP address, the reverse lookup give me the name. So
can we say it is a IP to name resolution?
Yeah, exactly, that's what it is. So name to IP resolution is a forward lookup, IP to name resolution is a reverse lookup.
Okay,
So if I say NS lookup again and say,
is it a mandatory?
It is good to have. It is definitely good to have. vcsa.agile.com. Okay, let's try ping. Normally ping works. There you go, it's resolving, right? It's
yes, resolving
10.10.10.212. Okay. So that's the forward yes. working, but at the same time, if I give this, the session can disconnect anytime again, but we'll reconnect. So it's not resolving. Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
And it's basically not even going to that, or it is not doing a reverse lookup as well. So maybe we try NS lookup here. Unknown. So that weird error message you are getting, I'm not happy with that. We can fix that. Okay, let's go back here and we are let's start from the beginning. So on the reverse lookup, what we are doing is we are going to create a first reverse lookup. Now reverse lookup is the same thing, 10.10.10.x. That is what we have. So we need to remember to do it reverse on the other side. Okay, so right click, new zone, primary zone, as I said, because it's the first DNS server we are running, not a secondary one. And over here, DNS server running on a domain controller in the domain, or to all the DNS server running in the domain controller in the forest, because it's the first one and this is the first forest we created, I would select the first one and go next. And then I can see that IPv6, IPv4 or IPv6. So we will say IPv4 because we are working on IPv4 mostly. And this is the reverse lookup. So basically it's going to be 10.10.10.10. If it is the reverse one, so what you can do is, if it is not a 10 or maybe 11 zone, then it will be 10.10.11. Then the reverse basically comes that whatever end IP is, like 101 or 212, at the end it will say 212.11.10.10. and then the resolution path in address.arm. So but because my zone is 10.10.10.10, so that is what you need to keep an eye on, the first octet here, but the octet changes when I change here. Maybe it is 100. Can you see that? So that is the subnet. 100 is becoming that subnet, right? So over here I have 10.10.10 and then next. Allow the secure DNS updates. That's fine. And then finish. Now let's go back and see the zone which I have created here. It didn't have this pointer record, right? So the pointer record is missing here. There is no pointer records. So if I go back here, double click this, update the pointer record to select karo, apply karo, select it and apply it and click OK. And then go back here. It's still not created. So what we do is we can manually create it. We can manually right click and new pointer record. Yeah, and then basically IP is there, 10.10.10. And then we go 121. Yeah, and then say VCSA dot agile ops. Yeah, no, agile.com. Okay, you can do it like this. Okay, click on OK. No, you need to browse. Sorry, select that, forward select, go back in, and it needs to exist to be able to create. Because it exists, only then it will allow. So it's this one we need to create. Click on OK. Click on OK. Okay, it says already exists. So maybe I didn't refresh it properly. Yeah. So this is what I wanted to see. I thought it will automatically generate anyway. So why did it generate it automatically? Because I went in here and this was already selected. I clicked on apply and OK. Because the zone already exists. Okay, so that's how simple it is. So let's try it again. We will try and create a new pointer this time. Maybe we call it ESX-01 and then we'll give an IP address 10.10.10.10.213, add a host. Yeah, that's successful. Refresh it. and we can see it here. And we go on the reverse, refresh it again, and it is here. So ESX, we go here and then we can just ping it on a reverse lookup first. No, let's do it properly. Let's ping esx-1.agile.com, and it is resolving to 13. It doesn't exist, that's why it will fail. It's not existing, right? And also we can ping it to the reverse IP, IP to domain name resolution 213 reverse lookup. Yeah, reverse lookup will not, it will ping it only, it won't resolve on ping, it will be only resolving on NS lookup, right? There you go. And NS lookup basically has resolved it and it has given us the IP address. Brilliant. So that is basically covering Active Directory installation. So the topic started with template, right? So we saw how we used a Windows 2019 template and we deployed a new VM with it and we installed AD. Before installing AD, we gave it an IP address, gave it a name, rebooted the server, and then restarted the server because we changed the name. Installed the AD Active Directory, and then once the Active Directory was installed, we configured it with a name. Because this is the first Active Directory, we configured it as the first Active Directory in the forest. And you know that because we don't have anything else, it's a greenfield, it's going to be the first AD in the forest. And once that is done, we went through and configured all the things, which is basically promoting the server to be Active Directory server. We did that and then we followed the wizard. We gave the domain name which we wanted. In our situation, we called the name as Agile. The domain is called agile.com. When we finished the domain, we also included during the installation DNS, because DNS is very important for vCenter server. It needs a DNS server to resolve the name and also the ESX as well. So that is why we added DNS as well. And we saw how to create, after we install AD, it reboots. Once we reboot, we log in as an administrator to the AD. And once we log in, we basically did some tests. We created some users. I showed you how to create some organizational units and some users. You can similarly create groups and add users to the group and give permission to that group so that you manage it very easily. If you want me to do a session, comment on below on how to manage users and groups. We are doing VMware classes, not virtualization classes, not Microsoft Windows 2019, but I'm happy to, you know, cover these topics. The last thing we did is to configure our DNS, and I showed you how to configure the DNS and also create a new DNS pointer, a DNS entry. And we also saw how to create a reverse lookup zone, because this is the first zone we created. And we also tested the zone after creating a DNS entry for ESX01, as you can see here. So I hope you guys enjoyed this session. It is a bit lengthy session than usual. So that's all for today. If you like my session, feel free to subscribe and hit the notification bell. Thanks. Bye.